Please note that this video has spoilers for the subject. Put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. The Matrix movie thoughts. The part where, you know, Neo realizes, again, you know, this isn't the Matrix. The danger that he thought was real is now proven not to be. So, you know, for a second time in the movie, he realizes that something he perceived as true wasn't. A lot of late 90s science fiction, you know, went into this, you know, all these changes, all this new technology, and, you know, as far as movies of that period, you know, science fiction movies of that time exploring whether or not the world is real, you know, a theme that really resonated. I would definitely say that this is better than Existence and The 13th Floor, although those, I do love those two movies. And I may do a review of The 13th Floor down the line. I have not watched Dark City. I was told by someone that I have no reason to distrust that watching Dark City means you can't, you know, it kind of ruins watching The Matrix for you. And he did say that he would still say I really should watch Dark City, but I can't have anyone or anything ruin The Matrix for me. It's one of the most, you know, people talk about, like, this movie or book or whatever changed my life. It, you know, yeah, it kind of did. And, you know, with that said, I don't doubt that, you know, I've heard that is an amazing movie. And based on The Crow, clearly Alex Proyas can make amazing movies. He just hasn't really since those two, more or less. But I, Robot is fine, but from what I hear, the more recent stuff he's made is absolutely dreadful, which might not be his fault. It's big budget, you know, it might be producer interference, I don't know. I don't necessarily blame him for them, but yeah, I'm sure that Dark City is also an amazing movie. I know people who prefer that to The Matrix and people who prefer The Matrix to that. And some, you know, some thought that this was a ripoff of Dark City and that, you know, even if you don't want to take people's word for, you know, they simply were made too close to one another. You know, like if you say, oh, but wait, one came, you know, Dark City came out in 98 and this came out in 99. By the time Dark City was released, the Matrix was so deep into planning and being made that they couldn't possibly have just, you know, no one could possibly have watched that movie and then say, okay, really quickly, we have to rework all this so it's like Dark City. It's that they both had very similar ideas at the same, more or less at the same time, which, like I said, you know, this kind of late 90s, you know, the approaching new millennium. It's, as far as I understand, that is kind of a thing when a new millennium is approaching. The same thing did happen in, you know, when it was 999 to year 1000 rather than, you know, 1999 to 2000. It's just, yeah, it really, it does something to our head, that thing of this high number is going to become a zero, and there's going to be another number, and it's going to be different. Yeah, it's just, you know, the year 1000 was the first time that, you know, a, you know, post, yeah, post Jesus' birth, age had four numbers, and 2000 was the first time that that number was higher than a one, that, you know, the newest. And yeah, it just, it really makes us think about the world that we're in on a very abstract kind of, just really dig deep there. And yeah, and this did use some of the same sets as Dark City, which again was just, they had some really similar ideas. You know, as far as I understand, that movie especially has a lot of neo-noir, and yeah, and I've seen, you know, I know that some of the cinematography even is very similar. I've seen stills where people compare the two side by side. Now, I quite like this movie's vision of this post-apocalyptic future. You know, you, before this, you already had a lot of these, and I, you know, a lot of them have this kind of, you know, the it's that a lot of people have died, you know, which, you know, is still the case here. We, you know, we do know that even before the Matrix, you know, Morpheus explains, there was, yeah, but usually it is, you know, just not a lot of the world's population is still alive. And in this, the fact that it's slavery instead, and, you know, an unknowing slavery at that, yeah, that's a really compelling idea. I wasn't, the software for it doesn't work well today, but the DVD, you know, I have, I don't think you can see it right now because my head is in the way, but when I walk on and off camera, you can see that I do indeed have the Ultimate Matrix collection with the 10 discs before I got that, which was a present from my ex-fiance, which I greatly appreciate. I got the DVD, the original DVD of, you know, I still have the original DVDs of the three movies, and I still wanted the Ultimate Collection, and yes, it was worth it. You know, I even have the Animatrix separately. I had all of them, and still have them. On the DVD of the original 99 one, they actually put one of the earlier versions of the script. And I don't remember all of the things that I'm glad they changed, but among them, at the very end, when Neo hangs up and then flies off, in that script, a child sees him flying off and goes like, Mom, I just saw a guy fly. And then the mother is like, come on, that can't be real. Don't say things like that. Yeah, I'm pretty glad they removed that. I really think the way, you know, him flying off like that is, you know, that's the exact right way to show it. And yeah, one other thing is that Cypher tells Neo that Morpheus had freed a bunch of other potential ones, and all of them thought that they were the one, and they died fighting agents. And yeah, I mean, that's an interesting idea, and I'm glad that they removed it, because they do, you know, I'm not going to go into that here, since I'm only spoiling the first movie, but there is an idea like that explored later on. And yeah, I think it's better that it got more time like that, that it, you know, wasn't here in the first movie, that, you know, also they really couldn't have done it twice. So yeah, really glad that. And it does also show that they did all, you know, they did already have the idea to, you know, more than one. Every time the rebels actually jack into the Matrix, there's a real sense of danger, even before we know what, you know, what the deal is with the rebels at all. The, you know, really the only time that it's that no one gets hurt at all is basically the few times that they plug in right around the time they wake up Neo. You know, there, you know, the most violent thing that happens there is Neo's mouth, the bug, and removing the bug. But, you know, other than that, it's there, you know, nothing too violent happens there. Meanwhile, every single other time, you know, at the very start and every scene after the, you know, yeah, the time they plug in to take Neo to the Oracle, you know, when they return from the Oracle, it goes wrong, you know. And, you know, in the climax, you know, these deaths are by the dozen. And it is uncomfortable that the movie does actually have the good guys killing dozens of people. You know, when in Terminator 1, there are also a lot of dead cops. You know, there are also a lot of cops murdered on screen. And that was clearly Cameron working through some issues, but he did make sure it was the villain who kills them. You know, here, it's the heroes, and it's kind of presented as heroic. And I remember when this was relatively new, when the film was new, someone suggested that simply, you know, they should be disabling them in other ways. And, you know, I mean, we know that, you know, like, it's not enough to hold a gun on one, they could still become an agent, but, you know, clearly, in this, you know, when killing the agent also means killing the person, and when he's become an agent, that is more or less the only way you can, you know, it's difficult to slow down an agent. You kind of have to, you know, if you get a real chance to kill the agent, you probably should, and that, you know, that is, it's awful that you had to kill that one person, but at least it's only, but, you know, the, every person we see become an agent here was fully awake at the time, and, you know, there were no broken bones or anything. Like, Trinity doesn't kill the three cops, she kills one of them, the other two she knocks out. And, you know, that third one she kind of did have to shoot. She didn't have time to, you know, further dodge all those bullets, but Yeah, you know, there's no indication that the other two were, and you know, it's just, I don't know, so in Splinter Cell Blacklist, you can run through levels largely just knocking people out, you know, sleeping gas grenades and, you know, knocking them out with martial arts and such. And yeah, I do think that, you know, if let's say they, instead of bullets, they carry tranks. You know, wouldn't look as cool, but I do think that I don't think the movie had to kill this many people at the hands of the heroes. You know, these are all, you know, just white guys in like SWAT gear or cop uniforms. And, you know, in the case of the agents, they look like CIA agents. You know, this is not, these are not people that, you know, and these are not knowingly protecting the slavery of the Matrix. You know, it's just a bit uncomfortable. I think that, you know, in action movies, when a lot of muscle of the bad guy dies at the hands of the good guys, the muscle know that they are muscle. They know what they're doing. They know what their boss is doing. So, yeah, that makes it more, you know, in that case, the movie killing all of these, you know, is more acceptable. And I do think that they could have, you know, like, when maybe there should have been some kind of private, like, that's also part of the thing. They appear to just be, these are regular cops, regular SWAT guys. You know, if it was like a private firm that, you know, that did the security, and this private firm, you know, they on some, you know, like the boss there was clearly evil or something, but you know, as it is, it's taking the kind of the government is using us, the government is abusing its power, that kind of feeling, and going a little too far in the other direction. And you know, one of the numerous influences for this are Akira. And in Akira, you know, the idea of violence against, like, for example, the police is less, like, it's relatively appealing in that film. But in that film, they're clearly they're using violence against peaceful protesters. You know, it's a police state, and it's clear. And I understand why they didn't. The thing is that the movie is supposed to evoke the world we live in, and you know, the just it's a tip the I'm not sure they do ever refer to it by any name, but the city is supposed to be a major American city. And yeah, you know, the seeing that many SWAT, yeah, you know, they've captured a terrorist, and they're protecting, you know, they're keeping him in custody and trying to, you know, they know that other terrorists might come to try to help him out. So there are a lot of SWATs, and yeah, it's a government building, you know, but yeah, I think that they needed to show something that, you know, like the closest we come to seeing regular, like, you know, like the SWAT and such be, you know, borderline sadistic, to where you're like, ah, I really want to see these guys, you know, is when they beat down Morpheus in the bathroom, but they think that he's a terrorist. They're, you know, I'm not sure we ever really get details. I feel like there was, I feel like I once read something saying that if you could read the full one of the articles that Neo, you know, that the computer cycled through, it had details about how he actually killed a ton of people to get away this one instance. And yeah, it's, you know, and when they do stuff, yeah, they're killing a lot of people. You know, I mean, yeah, you always see the SWAT guys come in guns blazing, basically, but you know, it's not like the heroes don't, you know, they're also killing. When, you know, like when Apoc and Switch escape from the, you know, they kill a few of the SWAT guys, but then they escape from the rest. Smoke grenades were just thrown, and I'm almost certain that those were thrown by the SWAT, not, you know, and that's something, I mean, yeah, hypothetically, you know, let's say they threw a smoke grenade and, like, you know, I don't know, something that would make it difficult for, like, I don't know, you know, rolled out some ball bearings so that the, you know, if the SWAT tried to run after them, they wouldn't be able to run in that direction, you know, just something other than just gunning people down. I suppose that more or less covers that aspect. And it's also just, you know, they rarely really show, like, you don't spend a lot of time seeing faces of these guys. You mostly just see them die. They're, you know, so they are relatively, like, they do feel more like cogs in a machine than humans. And similar to, you know, Terminator climaxes, the climax here really is one long battle. You know, they have one objective that they fight towards until the very end, and it blends different types of action to great effect. And the, you know, it is this thing, basically, as soon as they realize, you know, they return from the Oracle knowing, you know, they and then they find out that the, you know, they are being, you know, the SWAT are on their way. From that moment on, it's basically we have to get everyone, but especially Morpheus and Neo, out of the Matrix safely. You know, and then first, you know, that Morpheus sacrificed himself to make sure Neo gets back. And then they, you know, the other guys run, Cypher kills a bunch of them. And then, you know, Neo and Trinity go back in to free Morpheus, they free Morpheus, and then the very end is, excuse me, Neo trying to get back out of the Matrix, but it is one long, you know, the goal doesn't really change. Particularly, you know, the yeah. Now, I remember when this was new, some people were, you know, pointed out that, you know, Neo is shown to learn jiu-jitsu in seconds, and then we find out that, you know, he was there for 10 hours, you know, and they, you know, there aren't that many types of martial arts in the world that he could be, you know, yeah, learning for all that time. The way I see it, he did only learn the specific moves possible in seconds, because that's just data. And yeah, if you're feeding someone a lot of, you know, yeah, the specific moves, you know, if you're just streaming a lot of information right into someone's brain, yeah, that could be done in a few seconds. But then, once he's learned some, he then spends the, you know, that's like reading the book about it, you know, then he, you still have to practice them, and that's what he does for 10 hours like a machine. When he comes out and says, I know Kung Fu, what he's saying is, I have now practiced Kung Fu for, you know, maybe all of the 10 hours. As far as, and I already mentioned Akira, which I'll get back into briefly, I want to say that I read all of Ghost in the Shell. I know I played the demo of the game on PS2. I don't think I ever watched the film. When it comes to Akira, I read it, I watched it, and I still own the DVD. And rewatched it in preparation for this. The love story is really underdeveloped. The DVDs come with the commentary track of philosophers who love the movie and critics who did not like the movie. They do say some positive things. I had forgotten because it's been years since I last listened through the, you know, in the written introduction, the Wachowskis write that, you know, fans of the movies will probably, you know, be really frustrated listening to the critics' commentary track. They do say some positive things as well, and, you know, they don't, like, they point to like influences by other directors and such, and I didn't really get the feeling that they were saying, they just ripped that off. You know, they clearly respected the craft, but they do, you know, one of them sarcastically says of Neo and Trinity, it's, you know, because of all these meaningful conversations that they've had. And it's true. Their relationship is very underdeveloped in this movie. It's not that the movie does not develop relationships. Smith and Neo have a relationship. Smith and Morpheus have a relationship. Neo and Morpheus have a relationship, and there's, you know, they have conversations. They express what they think and feel, you know, very, very personally to the other, you know. I forget who said it first, but, you know, someone pointed out that when Morpheus says, you all look the same to me, that's basically him being racist. You know, it yeah, you know, he's saying that they just, yeah, that's something that is usually said about racist people. And it really, that's, yeah, Morpheus hates the agents, and Smith hates humans, and he sees, you know, there are different things. When he does not respond to Neo the same way he responds to Morpheus, you know, there are clear, like, he hates humanity, and like he says, he hates the cage of the Matrix that he feels trapped by as well. But yeah, he reacts to them, the two of them, in different ways. He's frustrated by their refusal to just do as he wants them to, but other than that, it's, yeah, quite different. And when you really stop to think about it, Morpheus really manipulates Neo. Like, he, at the end, he's proven correct. Neo is the one. And he does apologize for pulling Neo out so late. And Neo calls him on the manipulation, but yeah, Morpheus really pushes Neo. Now, Cypher, when I first watched this, me and a friend of mine and I, we, debated whether or not Cypher sneezed on purpose. See, I don't think that he did because it looks very natural. And, you know, Cypher too could have been killed there, and he didn't want that. He was not really willing to die for this. You know, he definitely wanted to get out alive. And when Cypher kills the crew, it does not quite have the impact because we don't really know them that well. But like I said in the review, we do have a sense of who they are. You know, it's, yeah, the different ways that the, you know, the way they talk about the food, for example, and the way they act around Neo, both before and after he's woken up, you know, there's a real determination to switch where, like, yeah, you know, she's not, like, just gradually, like, easing him into it. No, she pulls a gun on him and says, you're going to do exactly what we tell you, or you're going to leave right now. So, yeah, you know, there are some, yeah. And Neo goes, whoa, because it will never quite be forgotten that he was Ted. The old blind guy, you know, in the Oracle's building, you know, regardless of what we find out later in the franchise, I would still say this may be the case. He might be a security measure because he and Morpheus nod. If he's blind, how could he be sure to, you know, there's some kind of, you know, probably most of the time when someone walks in, they don't nod. And so this, you know, let's say supposedly blind guy, since he could tell that Morpheus nodded and he nodded back, then the blind guy just plays blind. And if someone went to where the Oracle is, then, you know, maybe the door would simply not open. Maybe there would be some armed rebels up there, you know. And, you know, in the real world, Trinity can be somewhat more feminine. And, you know, you do get a sense that her, you know, I mentioned that the love story is underdeveloped. You can tell that she is, you know, that she really cares about him. That, you know, that is clear, but it is just, it's the movie falling in love kind of thing, where she's just in love with him regardless of, you know, and to be fair, she was apparently in love with him before the movie started. You know, Cypher's, you know, you like watching him. Now, I quite like, you know, Smith, in spite of how much he hates humans, you know, he also does have these very human traits. The, you know, hatred itself is very human. You know, while it's not logical for a machine to hate, it might have a very distinct, like you see in the other agents, they are determined to stop the rebels, but it comes from this cold kind of programming of just, that is an enemy, I have to stop him, you know. But with Smith, it's personal. You know, he hates human beings, and he hates being stuck here. This really uses the themes of Philip K. Dick with, you know, it's the themes of reality versus simulation, of whether or not our memories can be trusted, and, you know, how our identity is based on our perception of reality and our memories, and thus if we maybe need to reevaluate our identity when, you know, something, if we learn that our perception of reality or, you know, our memories have been tampered with or are not dependable in some way, and, you know, we see that Neo needs to reevaluate his identity, because he finds that both his sense of reality and his memories are, you know, not real. And so over the course of the film, he does, you know, by the end, he genuinely does believe that he is, you know, he is the one. And, you know, if this had been the only movie in the series, you know, I have seen some people suggest that, you know, the ending, you know, the last portion of the film is just another fantasy, you know, which, you know, if this had been the only movie of the, you know, which, yeah, I do think that it's, you know, yeah, obviously the sequels are nowhere near as good, and they do really mess up what in this is a really great standalone story. But yeah, you know, I could see that, how it's, you know, it has that kind of sense of like, yeah, as some other films that, which I won't give away. And meanwhile, Cypher is trying to go in the opposite direction. He wants to embrace the fantasy. And I'm not sure they should have had it said more than once, because it becomes a little too obvious. But the thing about how he wants to be rich, and he wants to be someone important, like an actor, and Smith refers to him as Mr. Reagan. Yeah, you know, it's that's cute. I like that. But like I said, I really don't think they should have said Reagan more than once. And maybe, I don't know, maybe not even quite call him Reagan, but just something very similar, or, yeah. The, you know, he prefers the comfortable fantasy to the, you know, unpleasant reality. And they even, you know, they have the harp there to suggest Christian heaven. You know, they could have picked any upper class fancy instrument. They went with the harp, and they have this, you know, shot that really highlights it. You know, it's yeah, he's sitting here, he's eating incredibly underdone steak that's, you know, that he says is delicious, and, you know, he's drinking, it's a fancy restaurant, it's a nice place, and you have the harp, it's, yeah, it's heaven. And yeah, this theme is really very relevant in that, you know, in here in the modern world, the press and politicians really frame issues, you know, stories and ideas in a way that fits what they and their audience wants to hear. On, you know, even, and I mean that about the ones I listen to as well. If we had to break it down completely, then, you know, anything can be made to appear bad if you have enough detail, if you go into enough, like, the only thing you have to, like, if you want to make, like, incredibly rich, powerful people who ruin, you know, whose lobbying and, you know, playing with investor money, you know, yeah. If you want to make them appear sympathetic, all you have to do, you know, and this was actually done, you know, just do, you know, show, put a face on them and just say, oh, they're just, you know, they really care, and, you know, and leave out all the details about all the damage they do, and, yeah, I mean, that sounds, you know, and, yeah, you can always, and it is very, very much the case that it, that the stories are framed depending on, yeah. And, you know, Cypher even attacks people that he's worked with for years, you know, to protect his comfortable lie, you know, and this, you know, you, and this does also fit with, you know, religion, philosophy, various philosophies, politics. You know, I really don't mean to pick on Christians or Christianity, but, you know, something that we've seen a lot of time, you know, we've seen a lot of examples and heard details from situations where especially Christian families learn that, you know, someone in the family is gay or even an atheist, and they attack this person that they've known for years, that they've cared about for years, because it threatens the comfort, you know, their perception of reality. They can't, because this family is made up of good people. Good people aren't gay, so, you know, you must only be pretending to be gay. You must not actually be gay, and, you know, you need to just stop being gay. You know, that, yeah. And Mouse points out the power of sexual fantasy, and, you know, whether or not you think that him talking about it so openly is comfortable, you know, as he points out, it is entirely natural. And with the construct and with the reality of being able to plug in, it does make sense that, yeah, some people would want this kind of sexual fantasy. And, you know, they call him a pimp, which makes me wonder, because that's never clarified, does he actually take payment? He just says, I can arrange. He doesn't say, you know, because even in a reality like that, there would be something for leverage. You know, people will find ways to trade and barter. You know, maybe it's like, you know, food rations or something that they trade with. But, you know, and if he were to be paid, it makes sense. He did program it, you know, which does also mean that he's the lazy programmer who just, you know, kept copy-pasting the characters. You put, you know, that's the idea of the, you know, all these twins being put in the exact same clothes, and, yeah. And, I mean, it's not even really, like, it completely objectifies the woman in the red dress, which, you know, yeah, I mean, that brings up the, you know, women are entirely objectified, and that's, you know, they don't really go into that. Switch is clearly, you know, she doesn't like that this is, you know, but neither she nor Trinity directly say that shouldn't be. And, you know, I guess if you were to, you know, devil's advocate, technically the woman in the red dress isn't real, so, you know, whether it's, you know, yeah, regardless of what you do there isn't a person who's, you know, being made to do something. I am not going to be commenting on every philosophical idea in the trilogy. And I should also say, before I get into the next ones, I don't agree with everything that the film suggests, but I am going to explain it here as I understand it, and, you know, let you make up your own mind. The, you know, some people have questioned why the people plugged in to the Matrix, why are they allowed to be sentient at all? Why are they allowed to be smart? Why are they stimulated? A complex lie has the brain and body produce more electricity. You know, the more stimulated we are, the more, energy we produce. You know, you can, you know, sexuality is an example. You know, a body which does not, you know, is for a long time in a situation where it cannot have sex, and it just doesn't, you know, in that time it does not produce as much energy as, say, if that same person were in a relationship where they could often, you know, have sex. That, you know, and you know, before someone said, well, why isn't it an even better, you know, reality than theirs? That's what Smith explains. You know, we gave you heaven and you rejected it. The human mind requires at least some kind of, you know, you won't accept it if it seems too good to be true. And that is definitely something I agree with. And, you know, some have pointed out that, you know, human beings do not generate enough electricity to be useful generators. And, you know, if you were to do that at all, we should at least be like running on treadmills or something, you know, while plugged in. And that is technically correct, which some would say is the very best kind of correct, but given that it has such symbolism, and I do think that fiction gets a pat, you know, if this were a documentary, I would be 100% with it. If a documentary came along saying, if we were, you know, whether it was arguing for or against, if it were saying people plugged into a machine would generate a lot of electricity, I would absolutely be right there with you debunking it. But yeah, you know, the symbolism being people in the modern world are quote unquote plugged into machines, you know, machines that sap our creativity, our joy, our passion. You see it in Neo at his job, you know, worker drones in suits they hate, in gray, bland cubicles. I think it's noteworthy that we see Neo at his workplace. We even see a few, you know, we even see him sitting in his cubicle, but we never see him work. You know, he's like, he's sitting there mentally preparing, I have to do this, you know, and I briefly want to interject the, you know, I think it's the philosophers, not the critics, on the commentary who try to point out there's obviously some irony in Neo's awakening being delivered by FedEx. You know, that's obvious because FedEx is just another part of the machine. You know, so it's clearly, yeah, you know, sometimes they have a very distinct sense of humor, the Wachowskis, and, you know, it comes through here better than in the sequels. But yeah, you know, in these gray bland cubicles, and, you know, we spend almost half our waking hours staring at a screen doing work that is meaningless to us. we don't even see the results of our work, and it really takes a toll on us. We really haven't fully recovered from the brutality of industrialism, you know, where we abandoned the substantially more satisfying, albeit admittedly also incredibly draining and unforgiving, work on farms, where you can very clearly see the results of your work. You know, you deal with different animals and crops and such, and it actually leads, you know, you could, it quite literally puts food on your table. You know, you literally collect the food, and you can tell that what you're doing leads very directly to a positive result. You know, natural food, and like, you know, you only have so much freedom in what animals you can keep and how many of them and such, but the animals you keep very directly affect the food you eat. And you know, it's you're literally, you're part of a kind of natural cycle. You know, you're feeding, you're taking care of their crap, literally, and you then collect the food that they produce. You know, it's again grueling work a lot of the time, but it is something that comes relatively naturally to, you know, human beings like being around other living things, especially the ones that don't try to kill us. And, you know, again, to an extent, you know, farm animals are not all equally happy to be there, and some of them really don't like you taking their young and such for food. But at the end of the day, it feels good to go and get food for an animal that then is grateful that you got it food. You know, that's you can actually see your what you are spending all these hours of the day doing leading directly to a result. You know, the work we do doesn't benefit faceless machines, they benefit rich people. But, you know, so, you know, something, you know, living people do actually benefit, but we don't see these people, we don't see them benefit, not directly. Being directly employed by the rich and, you know, directly, like, fetching them things and doing things for them clearly has its downsides. But an element, not necessarily a positive one, is that you can see the person that is benefiting from what you're doing. You know, you can actually tell that you're doing something. You're not a cog in a huge machine that does something down the line that you can't see and or you may genuinely wish you didn't do. You know, there are tons of jobs that people have to just take because it's the best they can get. And, you know, yeah, they don't like what they end up producing, but they don't really have another choice. And, you know, we go back and forth between this meaningless job and a home life that also leaves us wanting more in machines, you know, cars or the dreaded public transportation. I'm really glad to live in Denmark and not like America where, you know, I can tell that public transportation is hated in America and, you know, based on how poorly it's kept up and such, I can understand why. Here, it's perfectly pleasant to use public transportation. And, you know, waking up, quote unquote, is not only easy, it's going against this existence, refusing to settle for this life. And, you know, yeah, this life that you don't want, that no one wants, that we settle for because it is the best we can do. And, you know, Morpheus says people are no longer born, they are grown, because people don't have kids hoping they'll actually do great. They just have them hoping that the kids will, you know, become rich, have a successful career. You know, we have children to replenish the supply of working sheep, not because we love one another and we want to together, you know. Yeah, you know, the idea is you look at another person and you're like, no matter what, I want another person to exist that's half me and half this one other person. Because that will give my life meaning, you know. And, yeah, you know, saying that, you know, to return to, you know, saying that, well, human beings can't generate enough electricity like that, you know, you are correct from a realistic standpoint, but saying, you know, it's not realistic, and thus I don't, you know, the movie doesn't work for me, then you're missing out. That's just, you know, the movie does not, is not trying to, well, as much as any piece of fiction is trying, you know, obviously it's trying to convince you of the reality that it presents, to some extent, but the film isn't about, you know, human beings would actually make great batteries or generators. Yeah, it's about that all the energy that we could be spending on something we care about, we're spending on something we don't care about and that we wish we didn't have to do. And, you know, it's very much about the commercialized, media-driven society of developed countries. And the idea of free will is explored via the Oracle. And this is very much cyberpunk with, you know, even the name The Matrix is from William Gibson, the father of the sci-fi subgenre of cyberpunk. A quite good quote that, you know, really denotes what is cyberpunk about is it revolves around the high-tech lowlife. You know, it's this very fairly technologically advanced, but nevertheless dystopian society, you know, with conflicts being around about AI or mega corporations, you know, fighting each other or the like. And it tends to be set on Earth and very much in this kind of, you know, city where, yeah, it's you know, your typical modern city. There's a lot of noise and dirt and kind of just, yeah, rather than these idealized kind of, you know, settings, and definitely not set in space. Often, some cyberpunk, you know, System Shock 1 and 2 are, you know, set in space, but still very much. But, yeah, and it takes a lot from film noir and detective fiction. Now, the storyboards for this were done by the incredibly talented comic artists Jeff Darrow and Steve Skroce, and they also created the insectoid robot designs. With Darrow's detailed disturbing, hallucinated nightmare style, especially, you know, yeah, fitting perfectly the real world with its just, yeah, and these machines that just so inhuman and so cruel and brutal. And, you know, our heroes very clearly just have had to patch together what they have from what they could scavenge. You know, it's dirty, ugly, used, not the idealized clean sci-fi of Star Trek and A Space Odyssey. Those are excellent, but this is an interesting and very intentional departure from that. And again, very much fitting this kind of cyberpunk. And I'm not sure cyberpunk had seen a real mainstream success before this movie. I know that, you know, speaking of Keanu Reeves, and, you know, there is John M. Mnemonic from 95, but I'm not sure that one did all that well. And from, you know, it's okay, but it really doesn't live up to William Gibson's writing. And, yeah, for those who don't know, that is based on one of his short stories. And, yeah, the production design team, you know, they made a real bias towards the Matrix code, distinct green color for the, you know, the program itself, versus this more blue kind of thing for the real world, and, you know, decayed monolithic grid to convey this cold, calculated, logical, artificial nature of the Matrix, versus, you know, where in the real world their hair is a lot less styled, there's more textile content to their clothes, and the cinematographers used longer lenses to soften the backgrounds and emphasize the actors. You have to wonder what is in those cookies that, you know, she says that by the time you've finished the cookie, you'll think about different, you know, you'll realize that you don't really believe in what I've said anyway. And, you know, and I forget, it might be on the IMDb trivia page, but, you know, it's pointed out that a cookie is something that, you know, in as far as, you know, internet kind of, you know, it's a file that contains some personal information, and the Oracle gives you personal information, kind of, yeah. Something kind of funny. Now I've talked a lot about the complexities and the smart things in this. When this came out, a lot of people thought that things they didn't understand in this had to be complex details that they just couldn't yet wrap their head around. They, you know, they asked others, and forgetting that the Wachowskis were young geeks. So, you know, when Neo says, "Mr. Wizard, get me out of here," that's not some, like, it's a pop culture reference. You know, I didn't watch it myself, but yeah, that's a thing where the character would yell, you know, "Mr. Wizard, get me out of here." And it's because, you know, it's something that Neo watched growing up, or thought that he did, yeah. And that, you know, actually, you almost have to wonder how or if Tank really understands that, because in Zion, you know, he's a child of Zion, as he says. So when would he have watched? But anyway, you know, and then, you know, the when he says, "Your left." No, your other left. You know, again, people are like, did the Matrix, did the the programs change so that he would think that one left was actually enough? Did they swap sides in the hallway? No. It's, if you say, go to, it's on your left-hand side, and then someone goes to their right-hand side saying your other left is kind of, it's like teasing them, like saying, no, you know, it's, yeah, it's just, it's basically saying left, not right. And, you know, I do quite like, I forget exactly who originally said it, but that the film is about defeating robots with kung fu. That's, yeah. And again, on the critics, they point out that the part of the climax that involves the real world, that's just not, we're invested in what's happening in the Matrix. We don't really want to be in the real world, you know. And ultimately, it puts an extra, like, there's, that's the ticking clock, you know. If you remove the real world consequence, if squiddies weren't on them, then yeah, you know, basically it wouldn't need to happen quite as soon, the you know, getting everybody out of there. So, you know, if you just straight up removed it, it wouldn't have the impact that it has. But it is kind of true that, you know, we don't really want, you know, what we're enjoying seeing these really cool, stylish things in the Matrix, and we want to see Neo win in the Matrix. And when they cut to the real world, it's just not as, you know, compelling. And one of the critics seems a little confused by what exactly happened there at the end. I don't think that it's too, like, you know, basically the moment that Neo actually picks up the phone there at the end, which it really is, like, he's just showing off. Like, once he become, you know, once he comes back to life, because, you know, she brings him back with the power of love, you know, at that point, I mean, I get that he spends like a second or two just trying to realize, okay, so I'm back, so I'm the one, and what does that mean exactly? But then he's, you know, and he did kind of need to stop Smith at least. But then once he blows up Smith, you know, yeah, he stands there for seconds and kind of just posing, and then the agents run off, and he's just standing there, and Trinity yells, Neo, and then finally, oh, right, there's real-world problems, you know, yeah, which needs to be a hashtag, not just first-world problems, but real-world problems for when you're not in the Matrix. But yeah, you know, the moment he grabs the phone, we know that that's when, you know, he's back outside of the Matrix and, you know, pulling the plug out from the back of his head now means that he just wakes up rather than it, you know, leaves the mind of the person in the Matrix. And yeah, so the moment that he picks up the phone, they can pull the plug and or, you know, use the EMP and it'll be fine. You know, during the subway fight, I mean, we know that Smith is the only of the three who know, you know, he was the one who picked up on the drunken homeless person there. But did the others just not at all pay attention? Because the moment that, you know, during the fight, I mean, because the moment that Neo actually runs out of the subway station, I get that it's nice and, you know, isolated, as they always try to make it for the, you know, and it was, you know, it was just rotten luck that there was just one person there to see, you know. It's like, yeah, it's an active, you know, there's, you know, trains run through, but nevertheless, this is not a place that, you know, people don't stay around there for a while. So, but they fight for minutes on end, and no other agents come running in. It's just, do they not wonder at all about what Smith is doing all that time? And the... You know, I get that Smith, because of hubris, he doesn't tell the other ones, but wouldn't they be able to tell? I don't know, maybe it's programmed based on the three of them always working together, and yeah. And I do want to say, I really love the casting for the agents, because they really, you know, the same goes for the cops and SWAT and such. It's, you know, they all just really fit the part, and just... The agents, a lot of it is just the face, because we spend a lot of time just seeing their faces. You know, they're not like, you know, they also have the suit, but it's fairly uniform for all three of them. But the actual, yeah, when you're just looking at them for all this time that you do spend looking at the agents, yeah, the faces, they just have this, you know, government agent kind of like company man thing. And I do, you know, I really like the humor in the action scenes. They're at the end after he's exploded Smith. And then, you know, he looks at the other, and the other two just look at each other and then they run off in different directions. You know, that's quite funny. And the lobby, you know, they place the you know, like gym bag kind of thing on the, you know, on the x-ray thing, and it runs through, and you know, the thing goes off, and Neo walks through, and it's one of those nice ones where it's not just that it'll turn, it's not just a lamp that'll turn red. No, no, it has a display, and there's only two greens, and it's like, I don't know, six or eight reds or something. So, yeah, you know, Neo just really quickly looks, where, okay, where is everyone? Who would I have to, okay. And the guy, you can just hear it in his voice. He does this a million times a day, and he is sick of it, because there's never anything, it never is anything. He even said, you know, please remove any metallic items you're carrying, keys, loose change. You know, he's had to tell this to a million people, and that's all it ever is. It's keys or loose change, and it just, you know, and you know, and Neo just flashes the guns, as it were, and he's like, you know, just the reaction there is great. And, you know, and they shoot them all, and, you know, you don't quite know if you're glad that Trinity didn't shoot that last guy before he called for backup, because if he hadn't, then we wouldn't have the badass lobby scene. But, you know, yeah, you know, if they hadn't showed up, they would literally have just walked through the room and then place the bomb, and that would be it, you know. But yeah, and it's also it's quite clever, you know. They get to the roof of the building, and they take out the main elevator so that no one can, you know, show everybody who fights them is fighting them from, you know, first they fight a few guys on the roof, and then they you know, fight the agents inside, you know, with Morpheus. You know, the no one is able to go up or down because of what they did. And as others have pointed out, the sprinkler wouldn't go off up in that room from an explosion on, you know, on the, you know, in the lobby on the main floor, or whatever you're calling, you know. Anyway, the Yeah, the humor and the after she guns that guy down, they throw the guns that they just, she picks up the bomb and they walk a few more steps, and then all these other guards run in and formation freeze, and then and you don't know exactly what they're going to do because the we know that he has a million guns on him, and they are there to fight. So and they look at each other briefly to just like kind of determine what are you gonna do, what are we gonna do, and then they just run off in different directions because I mean, they're not superhuman. There's that's a cute little thing. And I like the Terminator ref I love the Terminator references. The truck kind of, a the bad guy being in a truck and using that truck to try to like run into the heroes, and and the when the in the subway fight, one of the blows, while Smith still has his sunglasses on, it takes one of the two, I don't know what they're called, but the glasses up, whatever, takes part of that off, so he quote unquote loses, and one of his eyes becomes exposed, similar to how, the Terminator movies, usually Arnie will end up with an exposed, one of the red eyes, from under the, and the then there are the Akira references of, the using mind powers to stop a projectile part of the way, and I think I might be wrong about this, but I think when Neo kind of takes a few steps into the air and kicks in the face that last guy in the lobby, I think that was a reference to when in Akira, when jumps in the air and kicks a guy off a motorcycle. I think that was, and I quite like how, when you think about it, they're in the helicopter for maybe 2 minutes or something. They get in the helicopter, they travel down to the, fly briefly down to in front of the room, and there is no way that they fired, that many rounds and shot, and never hit Morpheus. That's ridiculous. There's no way. But yeah. And then, Morpheus jumps, and also that he lost that knee for sure. That's a Desert Eagle, and yeah, he lost that knee. There's no way that, in any kind of, even if even with bending and breaking rules, it's still a desert. Anyway, yeah, and then they're all safe with the helicopter, and then the tank gets shot out, and then they leave the helicopter. When you think about it, they're in that helicopter for almost no time, and that's really subverting expectations. Both, both that they lose it and that they lose it so soon. The fact, I mean, the moment that she gets in the helicopter, you kind of expect the movie to, okay, well, from now, the what they're going to do is the they're gonna fly off, and then and maybe the there's another government helicopter not too far away, maybe there'll be a chase. Nope, they just they they lose it almost immediately. The you just you never quite know where the action is going to go next. And I also like using the bomb on the elevator. You don't know what it is at first. You just you see that there, clearly there's some metal in the in the gym bag, and then, you know, and she drops it, and then she goes and picks it up afterward, and carries it into the elevator, and then opens it, and, you know, you see it's a bomb, and then they get outside of the elevator, and do the thing where they end up at the top, and then you're like, oh, okay, they blow up the elevator with, I mean, if not that, then, you know, someone could enter the lobby, and, you know, maybe if they couldn't use the elevator, you know, there might be something else that they could, you know, climb up the rope. I don't know, but, you know, it's always good in movies when something makes it, you know, we did not need to see where the character sat down and said, I think we should blow up the elevator. Why? Because instead we just see it in action, and, you know, we can tell what the plan was. And also, you know, not only does it subvert expectations, usually when a helicopter would be introduced in, you know, in an action movie, in that kind of, usually it would stay around more. There would be more with it, you know. And I quite like the, you know, the references to Westerns also with, you know, the way that in the subway, them kind of, you know, them standing for a few seconds, waiting, you know, it's a quick draw, you know, kind of, they're both going to try to draw their gun and shoot at the other. It's classic Western kind of thing. And, you know, even with a little bit of music flair, even though it's mostly silent until they then start shooting at each other. And yeah, and I'm not certain if the shots of, like, feet, I mean, that might be another Terminator thing, because James Cameron, yeah, but when Neo enters the lobby, you know, the first thing we see are just the, you know, his shoes, his feet, but it does have kind of that feeling of, you know, entering a saloon, you know, trouble is coming. This is, you know, it's not a person walking into a room. It's a troublemaker walking into a place where he's going to cause trouble. You know, it's very, and, you know, and the thing with James Cameron's shots of feet, especially in the Terminator movies, is that they do often, you know, it's the T-1000 stepping on and crushing Arnie's sunglasses. It's, you know, yeah, it's the entrance of a powerful character. And when, you know, sometimes in this, when an agent takes over a regular person, we also see the, you know, the foot, and especially with Morpheus, you know, right before Morpheus gets jumps into the bathroom, you know, you see the foot not only just there, but makes a brief turn and then walks into, you know, there's, yeah, again, it's a powerful character just entered the situation, and, you know, you don't even see the agent particularly before, you just see, you know, you see the foot, and then there's like a second or two of just silence, and then you know he starts shooting at the wall where Neo is, and then Morpheus sacrifices himself, you know.